Good morning and welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for March the 3rd. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Want to note that we had an executive session on February the 28th dealing with litigation, real estate, and personnel. Are there any additions or corrections for the minutes from March 25th? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Seeing none, we will move to the agenda. Item one under authorizing budget department. There's one item, adopt a resolution authorizing 2015 budget transfers in the amount of $3,376,333, 2015 appropriations in the amount of $123, 2016 budget transfers in the amount of $1,040,000, and 2016 appropriations in the amount of $511,035 per listing dated March the 1st, 2016. Under Human Resources, we have one item, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of the collective bargaining agreement between the County of Berks and SEIU Healthcare for a term January 1st, 2016 through December 31st, 2019, and this covers the Berksheim nurses. Under Purchasing, item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the award and the Director of Contracts and Procurement to execute and contract as a result of an invitation to bid a solar array feasibility study. That is going to the Stonehouse Group out of Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, a total not to exceed of $8,960. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the ward and the Director of Contracts and Procurement to execute two contracts as a result of food provisions for a period, as a result of a bid for food provisions for a period of 6 months for the jail system, residential center, and Berksheim. Caratus Foods, Reading, PA, their estimated 6 month expenditure is $12,853.51. Reading Coffee Roasters, estimated 6 month expenditure, $8,674.40. That's a lot of coffee. Commissioner Scott, one item, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Robert Bagenstos, Reading, PA, to the Council on Chemical Abuse Advisory Board for a 3-year term expiring January 31st, 2019. Commissioner Leinbach, there are two items, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Justin H. Istinez, Reading, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Park and Rec Board for a 4-year term expiring March 10th of 2020. And then item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of Carl Brown Jr., Reading, PA, to the Council on Chemical Abuse Advisory Board for a 3-year term expiring February 1st of 2019. Item two, a motion authorizing the chair of the board to execute contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator per the attached listing dated March the 1st, 2016. There are 7 contracts. There are 3 jointly with Children and Youth Services and Juvenile Probation. There's 1 with the Department of Emergency Services, 2 with facilities, and 1 with the jail. And then a motion to ratify and confirm payments is set forth in the Controller Office voucher listing. It's dated March the 1st, 2016 for the week ending March the 2nd, and the payment of the electronic transfers and employee payroll. That's been signed by the commissioners and is with our chief clerk.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second with discussion requested.
Sure. Motion's been made and seconded. Discussion.
Item 61-16, the resolution authorizing an award for a solar array feasibility study. That came as somewhat of a surprise to me. My understanding is that I had to scramble yesterday afternoon when I saw this on the agenda to try to get a history of what happened. I was able to obtain some documents. First of all, this is not a tiny project. The footprint that upon which this solar array could be placed is 19 acres, according to my research, a site that incorporates part of the former Berks Heim, which was, as we all know, demolished in 2013. It's 3 to 5 megawatts, which is the largest potential site allowed in Pennsylvania. I don't recall how or why this was started. It's possible this was discussed at a budget meeting when I was not present for personal reasons or whatever, but I've heard nothing of it since, and yesterday was the first that I learned of it. It's $9,000 to study something that if we're not prepared to spend the money on, I don't see the point of spending $9,000 to study a project that is very capital intensive. I've spoken to a local firm, RMK Solar, which is headed up by Mr. Robert Klein, who told me on the phone today that they routinely study such things and provide proposals to corporations and municipalities for free. So I'm a little disturbed by $9,000. I've done some research on the solar projects in general, and I've followed the solar industry because it's an interesting industry for some time. Solar companies that install these projects on a grand scale nationally, companies such as First Solar, and there's a couple others, have fallen on hard times because their projects are only viable if subsidized by a combination of and/or grants and/or investment tax credits, which were 30% of the project's cost, and were scheduled to go down to 10% at the end of 2016. I know there's some battling back and forth in the U.S. Congress about whether or not to extend these tax credits, but the bottom line is that solar, generally, with the exception of the state of Hawaii, which has the highest electric rates in the United States, is not competitive unless it is subsidized by government. So, despite what all the people who love the environment, including myself, think, solar energy and wind energy are both very expensive and unless subsidized are not competitive. When you think that it's competitive, okay, we'll take a government tax credit, which by the way is not available to municipalities because they don't pay taxes. Okay, we'll take a grant. The grants aren't free. Grants come from taxpayers. Grants come from either state or federal government, and they get the grants through raising taxes. If they don't come from grants and they come from investment tax credit, that means that the guy who installs the solar panels pays less taxes than somebody else who doesn't install the solar panels. So the other guy is paying the taxes for the guy who does install the solar panels. Again, this is tampering by the government with the free market economy, something with which I've long disagreed in most cases. I believe there are exceptions to that, basic infrastructure, certain projects that are unique. I understand that. I don't understand why we would be getting into the electrical business. Electric rates, by the way, are not rising because, unless it's because of some regulatory issue, the price of coal and natural gas have fallen through the floor, are actually probably almost at or below the cost of production, which is why they're capping or failing to pump certain wells and mine certain areas in the country now. I think in Montana, all the coal production is almost ground to a halt. The railroad companies are suffering from that. So energy is a super bargain. Why we would be getting into a high price source of electricity at a time like this, I don't understand. Why would we be paying $9,000 for something that could be provided for free? I don't understand. So if someone can explain this to me to my satisfaction, I might be persuaded to tolerate this. But I talked to this individual this morning who's in the business, and they said very few municipal projects, if any, are going forward because the investment tax credits are not available. Interestingly, there was a previous study by this firm, not the one on the agenda, but for free, RMK Solar looked at a project at the prison. And the reason the prison project for solar energy didn't go forward was the absence of a grant. Again, a need for one government to subsidize another government to get high-priced electricity in a feel-good project that might warm the hearts of people who are extreme environmentalists, but that don't make any economic sense. So I'm at the outset, not having the information I'd like to have, but having done the homework I could do in the very short period of time in which I was aware of this proposal, I'm very skeptical, and I'm probably going to be a no vote. Is there any response to that? Is there any history to this? Is there a rationale for
why several years, actually. I don't know where you've been. I mean, seriously.
Probably 2 years.
We've been talking about this, and nothing has been decided. I've had multiple calls from several firms that saw the RFP. I am by no means...
When was the RFP approved by the board to go out? When was it approved? It's dated October 15th. Well, who approved it?
I can't tell you that right here. I wasn't aware that you weren't aware.
Well, you don't know where I've been. I don't know where you've been if you're issuing RFPs and we don't know why they're being issued.
Look, this has been discussed at budget meetings. I have, I don't know if it's monthly or bi-monthly meeting with different department heads, in this case facilities. I've asked questions of facilities through the process. Nothing in my mind, apart from looking at feasibility, has been discussed beyond that. I'm not anywhere close to saying, let's go ahead with a solar project. I want to know, want to see the data. But I'm taken back because I believe it's close to 2 years that this has been going back and forth. It's been discussed.
We discussed this sort of concept with Naresco years ago.
Yeah, that's...
And they said, we ruled it out of hand because it was a feel-good project with a low return on investment.
Correct.
And didn't qualify under those conditions. So something must have changed since then, and I don't know what it is, but I don't think much has changed since then. The fact of the matter is that the government grants and subsidies and tax credits are required to make these projects feasible. And I don't know why we're getting into the electric business or even thinking about getting the electric business. Why would government compete with one of the most efficient industries in the world, our own electric utility industry? I don't get it.
And again, we will get the information for you. I will recommend in the interest, I don't think there's anything sacred about this date, that I would support pulling this item from the agenda until... the information is made available.
Well, for my part, if we can get someone to do a feasibility study for free, I'm all for it. I do vividly recall that once we demolished the old nursing home, we attempted to have Mike Brocker farm that field, but due to the fact that we had crushed building products in the ground, he was unable to farm it. So about 2 years ago in June, as part of a CCAP tour in Dauphin County, I was able to basically tour their solar array field they had constructed through their Industrial Development Authority, and thought that that might be a decent opportunity to utilize those 19 acres that are sitting fallow and unusable at the North Campus. And I do recall we've had several conversations at budget meetings about it. So that, for my part, that's what I know.
And I would also add, I was contacted by the firm that did the work in Dauphin County several weeks ago. They said the same thing, that we provide this at no cost. I contacted Ryan Hunter. I asked Ryan Hunter to speak to them because I felt if we could do it at no cost, that would be best. He spoke to them, and my understanding is what we're doing and what the quote-unquote feasibility studies that they do for free are somewhat different. But again, I have no problem supporting pulling this, getting answers to the questions. There's no reason to jam it through. But again, it has been discussed for quite some time, and you're correct. It was driven off looking at the success of Dauphin County and saying, is this something we should look at here in Berks County?
Yeah, I certainly don't think we have to rush to judgment, so I'm okay with pulling it off.
But, okay. Yeah. Do we need to... I need to amend my motion
to eliminate whatever the number is.
I will second that.
61.16.
I will second that amended motion.
Motion's been made to amend the motion for approval by deleting 61.16. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, the motion is carried. Now the main motion before us is to approve the agenda minus that item. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, the motion is carried. Our county treasurer is not available today. We do not have a report. He let us know that in advance, so we'll catch up next week with the treasurer's report. We'll turn to Sandy Graffius for the county controller's report.
I think the treasurer's in Atlantic City trying to double our...
Yeah, you're live on television, Mr. Troutman. Was that appropriate? I think you owe Mr. Adams...
I thought it was pretty funny.
Yeah, it's pretty funny, okay.
Yeah.
I think he actually is training some new employees.
Play the craps table.
Oh, I can always count on you.
He's going part-time to Trump University. He wants to hone his skills.
Right. I want my $35,000.
I was going to say part-time.
Good luck.
Total accounts payable, $1,388,812. We had wire transfers, $3,940,000. We did not have a payroll this week for a grand total of $5,329,181.10.
Very good. We'll turn to Carl Lincoln for the Chief Operating Officer report.
Thank you, Commissioners. Just to let you know, we have our operations meeting this afternoon beginning at 2 p.m. We're going to touch on at 2 p.m. For about 15 minutes. There's one part in the initial draft of the security assessment regarding elevators and things that they're requesting that we include in our elevators, certain features, and given the upcoming project, I believe it's best that we at least discuss that one portion today. And if you need that section, it's on our shared drive, but if you need that section, let me know, and either Amanda and I can print that out for you. Then we'll be discussing dispatching run cards, and that discussion at the request of Brian Godshall. I believe we'll need our solicitor there for her opinion and input. Then we'll be discussing SUVs and a debriefing of the snowstorm and the use and allocation of 4x4s and other equipment to make it available, especially for DES. And then lastly, we'll be discussing the Fire Training Center water tower. Thank you.
Very, very good. We'll turn now to the commissioners. Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. Just one item of note. Today at 11 a.m., I'll be meeting with our transportation planner facilities as well as PennDOT on our application for Wiley's Bridge, the well-known bridge in Onalani Township, which is a Whipple Trust bridge, and I believe there's about 10 left in the United States. This bridge has been closed for going on 3+ years. Prior to us demolishing it, we're still looking for opportunities to restore it. And this proposal would include the fact that it would not be open to vehicular traffic, but would be open for emergency purposes only with a gantry-type device or bollards, and can be used by the pedestrian and bicycling public. So we're looking at that to try to leverage some money from PennDOT in order to accomplish that prior to taking the next step and removing this bridge, which has historical value to many people in the community. And of course, it's been, since it's been closed, it's been used quite often by biking enthusiasts and walkers. And prior to that, it had been used as a shortcut to keep people off Route 61. But all that being said, we're hoping through this process, we can secure funding from PennDOT to keep the bridge in its historical value, to rehabilitate it, and potentially to go back to the township again for a second time to see if they're interested in acquiring it from the county once those renovations are completed. So I will update my colleagues next week after the meeting.
Very good.
Thank you.
Commissioner Scott?
I have nothing further. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. A couple of items. This week, I believe all of us received information from Dave Klein on a report on the Reading 120. That's the bike race that took place here last September. The information is encouraging. For the first time, $119,000 in direct local expenditures in area businesses. $75,000 was the value of the media coverage from a marketing standpoint. When we look at some of the participation, we had race teams. There were 33 teams. There were 165 international racers. There were 33 local participants. And there were a total of 21 countries represented. I think this bodes well for the potential of the race occurring again this year. I think what's more important is the sponsors and promoters have started a lot earlier this year, and I know Dave Klein has been a big part of that, so I thank Dave for sharing that. On Monday, there was a special event that took place over at the DoubleTree called the Returning Citizens Career Fair. This was a career fair set up by Berks Connections Pretrial Services, specifically by the part-time position funded at the end of last year for 16 by the county. The lady that works for BCPS is Cindy, I believe it's Fontana. I met her for the first time. The event was extremely successful. I asked Peggy Kirshner if she could send me the details, and here's the information. They had just under 500 job seekers come through the program, and it was extremely organized. When we got there, and I'm not sure what time, I think it was around lunchtime, a little before, a little after, they had 100 plus people in line. And then there were three different rooms where they would be sent once they checked in. They had 35 employers that were there. They had 50 volunteers. And the volunteers were doing things like helping people improve or prepare a resume. They were doing mock interviews, and then volunteers helping people get from meeting room to meeting room. There were three individuals hired on the spot, and the following companies indicated to BCPS that they're planning to hire at least one candidate as a result of this. And I'm going to recognize those companies. Cambridge Lee, the Morgan Corporation, Express Lawn and Landscaping, Berks and Beyond, Freedom Toyota, Sadasani Landscaping, Top Notch Construction, Liberty Tax Service, Elegant Temps, E.J. Brenneman, Rita's Water Ice, Big Vision Foundation, S&S Structures, Queen City Restaurant, Why Missing Family Restaurant, and Kugel's. That's a pretty impressive program, and I want to send out kudos to BCPS, to their team, and especially Cindy, Peggy, and Michelle from BCPS made it very clear to me that Cindy's the one that pulled this together. They had several brand new companies participate. I know one of them was Sadasani. I know the owner there, and when I talked to him, he said, this is the first time we've ever done this, and I'm really impressed. It's much better than I thought it was going to be. So that's a good thing to see. Anything from our row officers? Any comments from the public?
Motion to adjourn.
Meeting is adjourned.